Commission's representative. Hello and welcome. My name is Dial Delaney and I'm an admissions representative for the DeVos Graduate School at Northwood University. My role is to guide you through the admissions process and act as your advisor throughout the enrollment process. Our agenda for today will be as followed: an overview of Northwood University and the DeVos Graduate School, discussion of General Motors Partnership, hear from a current faculty member who will speak on clarity and precision in communication, scholarships and admissions process, questions and wrap up. If you do have any questions, please type them into the chat on the right-hand side of the screen, where you will answer them during and after the presentation. So let's get started. We are so pleased that you are investing your time today to learn about the partnership General Motors and Northwood offers to help you advance your career. We see education as an investment that has a great ROI. Northwood University and General Motors has partnered for over 5 years to offer the Executive MBA. We have been partnering with the industry for decades to ensure that what you are learning in the classroom has a direct application to what you are doing professionally. We have a 60-year plus history of educating the automotive industry, and that is a truly a testament to a long-standing partnership that Northwood University has had with your industry. So next, I would like to turn it over and introduce you to Dr. Matt O'Connor, who is an assistant professor here at the DeVos Graduate School. Dr. O'Connor has over a decade of experience of strategy, marketing, and research consulting for major corporations like Nestle, Keurig, Dow Chemical, and John Deere. Matt is our lead faculty for leadership courses here at the Graduate School and is the founder of the leadership training and development firm, Growth Corp Leadership. Let's welcome Matt. Good morning, Matt.
Hey, good morning, Dial. And thank you for the introduction, and thanks to everyone for logging in and spending some time with us this morning to kind of hear about our program and get a little bit of a sneak peek into how we approach a specific topic. So like Dial said, I'm a faculty member here at the DeVos Graduate School. I've been here about 3.5 years, and I'm biased when I say this, but it's a phenomenal program. You know, our Executive MBA available to the GM family is really quite powerful. It's 100% online, as you can see here on the slide. I'll talk a little bit about just some nuts and bolts of the program, and then I'm going to give you an idea of how we start to apply things that we learn about and discuss in our program pretty quickly and throughout the program in a way, and that'll start to reveal some of the more interesting aspects of our approach to learning here at DeVos. So the Executive MBA through General Motors, 100% online, it's accredited by the Higher Learning Commission, which is important. 2-year program, it's an integrated curriculum in that concepts and tools and philosophies that we learn about and discuss in one course are applied in different courses, and there are threads that get woven throughout the program that really start to magnify some of the learnings that take place in our MBA program compared to some of the other ones out there. And we really do focus a lot on leadership and management skills. We embed that into almost every course and every assignment in many ways, even though we have individual courses dedicated to those topics. The idea of leadership within operations or leadership within marketing, those come up naturally. So we're able to kind of synthesize learnings across the curriculum, which is kind of unique. Our process is unique, and I'm going to talk about how we go through that a little later on in the discussion today, but you learn from me as a faculty member. You also learn from your peers and your classmates. We don't necessarily lecture or PowerPoint. You know, this isn't the type of thing we do in an online program. It's collaborative. It's discussion-based. You know, I bring my expertise to the table, but we combine that with yours, and we try to unlock the expertise and knowledge that everyone in the class has. And that's really, in our opinion, one of the best ways to elevate the level of learning that takes place in online education, as opposed to a one-way conversation from a professor down to a student. It's multi-directional, coming from all angles, and that's really where the really interesting and unique insights take place. And so that's kind of a bit about how we approach it, how it's a little different. And we also try to apply the coursework that we do. There's an application bias in our program, which you'll hear me talk about quite a bit as we move through this brief conversation. We like to focus on approaches, on initiatives, on behaviors that are real and that are tangible and that are taking place on a daily basis in the work world. And that's where application comes in. We focus a lot of what we do on questions like, okay, what does this look like in your office? How do we apply this in the real world, as opposed to just focusing on the readings or the cases that we use to teach? It's the application focus kind of helps elevate our process a bit and makes it really, really both strategic and tactical at the same time. And that's, I think, one of the things I'm most proud about as being part of a faculty member here at the graduate school. So I encourage anyone who has questions to ask them in the text box or follow up with any of us as we move through this. But our program, I think, is powerful, it's differentiated, it's engaging, it's collaborative. And if you're interested and you're here on this webinar, you're interested in professional development and growth. So it's a really good, strong step for you to consider moving forward. Okay, so talking a little bit about a topic. We like to do this in these webinars where we talk a little bit about the program and how we approach things, because that puts it in context. You get an understanding of what a particular day, not even a day, but what a particular slice of a particular day might look like in our program, to give you a sense of how we approach learning, how we apply the tools that we are discussing or developing in the classroom, both the physical and the virtual classroom. And one of the topics that is near and dear to our hearts at Northwood and the graduate school in particular is the idea of feedback. All right, but not just feedback in general. And I want to set the table a little bit and define what we talk about when we talk about feedback, but delivering feedback or communicating feedback with clarity and precision. And that's something that we practice here at the graduate school, and something that we focus on in our daily lives. So this type of topic would show up in our organizational behavior class. It shows up in our leadership class as specific sections that we work on. But also it runs throughout the entire program in your finance classes when you're doing group projects, or in your strategy classes when you're doing presentations. So this mindset, this approach to communicating feedback with clarity and precision, is something that's immediately used in our program and then continually throughout the program, and hopefully ideally after you leave the program, or also while you're in it too at the same time. So why do we care about it though? That's the focus. So I might begin a conversation on a discussion board or in a video chat, but why do we care about feedback in our organizations? And we would have a group of readings, maybe two or three articles or a case around this topic in a particular class. And the takeaways might be one, feedback is essential, right, to the growth of individuals and organizations. We need to know how we're doing. And it's important for us when we talk about feedback to separate it out from performance review, right? That's not really what we're talking about, where you're setting your goals for the year and you're benchmarking your accomplishments. This is sort of real-time, continuous improvement dialogue that takes place across multiple people in an organization. We need that. People need to understand how they're doing, how they can improve, what they're doing well in order to continually grow. And the reason why we need to do that is there's a robust business case for it. You'll see in points 2 and 3 up here. Organizations with strong feedback practices perform better across many dimensions of organizational effectiveness. There's a compelling business case for it that's proven out there. So we need to, as leaders and managers of an organization, incorporate feedback. And we must incorporate it well. We must optimize it, because so often it's done suboptimally, as I say. It's done, and we'll get into why that happens in a little bit. So when we talk about communicating with clarity and precision, we're talking about delivering that feedback, that information to people who need it, who want it, and who are going to implement it. And that requires a certain skill set. And the more that you do that, the more you practice at it, the better it becomes. And you'll hear me talk about this too. The ideal scenario or the ideal environment around feedback is when it's not an event that takes place where people get together and provide feedback. It's when it morphs or transforms into an ongoing dialogue within your organization and becomes part of your culture. That's rare. Very few organizations have that and do it effectively, but that's the ideal state that we want to work towards. And we try to practice that here at DeVos. In my classes, I ask for feedback constantly from students about how the course is going, things we need to change, things we need to adapt or modify. I need that information to be successful. And there are techniques that we can use to communicate it to ensure that it is both constructed properly, but then also communicated and received properly. So what I have up here on this slide is a basic overview of a communication model. So we're not talking a communication class per se, we're talking about feedback within the context of organizational behavior and leadership. So we'll take a concept out there like this Yale model of communication and persuasion that is really popular and well known, but it gives us a framework through which to practice our skills and to learn and to hone our ability. So the feedback process is part of the communication process, which is really complicated, as you can see on the right-hand side of the slide. There are a number of different variables and processes that take place when we try to exchange information with people. The three big ones, right? There's the source, the message, and the audience. So the source is who you are. If I'm giving you feedback, that's my expertise, that's my perception or my perceived trustworthiness in your eyes. How well do you like me? What's my status, right? Not all feedback, not all sources are created equal. People have different levels of trustworthiness. They have different levels of expertise, and that factors into whether or not our feedback is received and understood, right? That's on one end of the spectrum. The other end would be the audience, right? The person we're directing feedback or information to, we're communicating with someone. Those folks that we're out there, right? We're persuadable. We have different levels of intelligence. We have different levels of openness. Our personalities are different. Some are introverts, some are extroverts, right? So the source and the audience are on bookends, and in the middle is the message, right? And that's really what we want to focus on as part of not only this particular brief talk, but how we focus on it in class as well. The content of what you're providing. How do you deliver it? How do you structure it? The appeal that you're making to someone. What do you want the person to know? Because that's key to comprehension and how it resonates and ultimately changes in behavior. So the source and the audience and the message are critical interrelated variables, right? And they all play a role in the process. But from our perspective, the source and the audience are incredibly complicated. They're ambiguous, there's subjective components, there's a lot beyond our control. Now, that's not to say we're not going to focus on them in class on how we understand credibility or how we use persuasion or how we relate to people using empathy and things like that in our program. But from strictly a communication perspective and looking at it from a clarity and precision perspective connected to feedback, the message is what we can control, all right? How we deliver it, what it says, right, and how we clarify things. So clarity, and that's why we kind of put this title on here for the presentation, clarity in communication is an intellectual standard that we can hone and practice in our lives. In one of our earlier classes in the program, it's called Fundamentals of Effective Decision Making. We talk about intellectual standards and intellectual traits, things like clarity, things like trustworthiness. We try to develop and hone our skills around intellectual humility, intellectual rigor to help us be better thinkers, to help us solve problems more logically and objectively. And clarity is one of those standards that we can practice, right? Because the style that we use and the approach that we take for delivering information is essential to the feedback integration process, which you see up here on the screen. So when I'm exchanging information or feedback with someone, it goes through a process, right? I tell someone something about their behavior. Your performance in that meeting was, well, this is a real-time example, wasn't that hot, okay? That's a vague example of it. But someone who hears that I'm talking to will absorb that information internally, and they will process it. They'll run it through a series of past experiences. They'll run it through their own value systems. They'll look at me as the source, say, do I trust this person's opinion or their perspective, right? And then we begin a dialogue or an exchange around that feedback where we clarify and confirm it, right? They can ask me questions, I provide more information, and that's the critical piece to understanding the feedback, right? So we communicate information out to people, someone absorbs it internally, they process it, they confirm it, they understand it, and then the next step would be implementing it. So the feedback integration process is complicated and it has multiple steps. That's what we like to do a lot of times in the program, is deconstruct these things down into their smaller pieces and learn where the weak spots might be or the weak links in that process might be, and focus a lot of our learnings or efforts on strengthening those areas. And the idea of communicating with clarity and precision fits in all five of those steps in many different ways. And the important thing to remember, though, is feedback that our people in need, our organizations need to perform, to evolve, to adapt, grow, whatever verb you want to use there, is out there. It's floating around our organizations. We need to seize it. It's incredibly relevant information that we don't always take advantage of. So there's an opportunity cost for choosing to focus on other things as opposed to focusing on feedback and information. And I really do believe that that's a missed opportunity for a lot of organizations to capture that information that is out there. Okay. So how do we go about it, right? I mean, if I have a situation with a person that works for me, they're not performing well, maybe this is the first time in a meeting, and maybe they were unprepared or their behavior was not reflective of how it normally is, right? How do we begin this process of communicating feedback clearly so it resonates, so they understand it and implement it? The first step, and these aren't groundbreaking steps, but they're hard to do and hard to put into play on a daily basis, is to practice. We need to think about the situation, and we need to know what we have to say. Okay, this takes time, it takes thought and preparation. And this is important because preparation is critical to credibility when it comes to delivering feedback. People can give you feedback at the water cooler, in the parking lot, but if it's not thought out and it's not credible in some way, you can actually do more harm than good. So in certain relationships where you don't know people really well, trust is underdeveloped, maybe it's fragile. Trust is very fragile, okay? It's hard to earn, it's easy to lose. Preparation is critical. So put in the time up front before you talk to someone, and that will help you get your mind right and your words in order so you can communicate more clearly. Focus on actions and examples. We talk a lot about this in our program. Don't focus on the people or the behavior, focus on the actions and examples and the impact of those on the organization. And what that really does is that helps separate out the information from the individual. And this is what I preach a bit in our classes where we study feedback. You want to make sure you depersonalize the message as much as possible. And that's important when we get to the next step. So people will naturally become defensive in receiving feedback. By focusing on their actions and the impact of those actions, when you did this, the organization reacted this way. I mean, that helps separate the feelings from the feedback, because if you don't do that, right, fight or flight can emerge. If we're not ready for feedback, or we're defensive, or we're not sort of, it's not embedded deeply in our organization, as a cultural construct, we might not react positively to it. So that's why we need to create feedback, an environment where feedback is more than an event, because in stressful events, people's minds tend to be complicated with different things, and the message that you're trying to communicate can get obscured when emotions take over. So we want to kind of keep that as objective as possible. Not easy to do, as we'll talk about in the next slide. So after you've done some preparation work, you know, you've practiced a bit, you've focused on certain things, you've created an environment here where you want to depersonalize it, then you need to go back and start to connect with the person, all right? This is what probably some folks might argue me on. I think that there's an emotional and psychological aspect to this process that we need to be considerate of. I like to tell people, don't become robotic or mechanical when you deliver your feedback. Empathize and acknowledge if there's discomfort or conflict going on. You can't ignore it, okay? Because we're all human beings in a lot of ways. So if that's out there, address it first and foremost. From a messaging standpoint, though, you need to really simplify what you're trying to say. People will remember less versus more. I like to say, you remove all the jargon, the fancy words, the tangents, the stories. Be simple, plain, direct. You know, I needed this deliverable. I need this deliverable by 3 p.m. Friday. You know, that's very specific. A lot of times when I'm giving feedback, I will go the vague route, like you just heard me in that example. Your performance in the meeting wasn't so hot. What does that mean, right? So if I need my deliverable by 3 p.m. Friday, tell me that. Don't say before the end of the week, because that's open to interpretation. And as we know, in our society and in our world, we're inundated with information from a variety of sources, and simplicity is essential to understanding and remembering. That being said, simplicity is different than being simplistic, so you want to make sure you choose your words carefully and you're actually communicating what you really want to communicate. And that's why the next step in the process for being clear is to expose the real issue. All right, we talk about sandwiching in feedback a lot, which means don't place your core argument or the most important piece of information between two less important ones or less critical ones. I'm guilty of this all the time because we don't want to hurt people's feelings. You know, we don't want to be negative all the time. So we sandwich things by saying, hey, you did a great job on that report. Your presentation was just okay, but the report was really good. All right, what I might have wanted to get at there was your presentation needed a lot of work. Let's sit down and figure out how to do it. But by sandwiching that feedback between two less important pieces of feedback, you could argue, it obscures the message in the person's mind and the audience's mind. So it's important not to do that sort of thing. What you really want to do also, though, at the very end is confirm, right? And that's how we clear up any misunderstandings or does this make sense? How can I help? What's next? That sort of thing. So as you go through the communication process, you have to put in work on the front end. Do you have your messaging right? You have your examples right and the environment correct. And then when you actually communicate, you need to try to keep it objective because the emotions can hijack our thought process. So we can streamline our messaging so it resonates, focus just on the most critical aspects, and then confirm if that feedback is received, okay? So that's kind of how we approach being effective in delivering feedback. And like I mentioned, that's one topic within a week of multiple topics. So feedback is combined with a number of different sections. We might have a feedback section combined with organizational culture, because we like to think sometimes feedback can become a cultural value in organizations. We would give you an article that gives some step-by-step approaches to delivering and receiving feedback. We would share ideas about it online throughout the course of the week. We will have a case to do on it as opposed to midterms and exams. We don't do midterms and exams in this program. All right, everything is applied. We think the best way for you to learn and to extract value from this experience is to apply it in real situations, as real situations as we can come up with, as opposed to just memorizing things to regurgitate on a test. That doesn't interest us here. And learnings and tools are integrated across courses and assignments. So what I just described is one example of how you can think about being clearer in your feedback that you can use tomorrow if you're sitting down with someone at work, or you can use in a future class in our program where you're doing teamwork, right? So these tools are valuable and they're relevant and they're diverse in their applicability across different contexts. Communicating feedback is necessary throughout our program. We put a lot of emphasis on course evaluations, on student feedback, on continuous improvement here. So we want it done optimally. We want to optimize the process. So communicating feedback with clarity and precision is one example of how we kind of live the values here at Northwood in a lot of ways. What's fascinating too is when we end our program, the GM Executive MBA ends with a capstone project, and the experience is rich with feedback opportunities. This student here, Molly Hilberger, went through our program. And what you do is a sort of directed study where you aim to identify a real problem in your organization that has dollar value consequences. And you try to diagnose that problem, explore it, and solve that problem. And throughout that whole experience, you're getting feedback from faculty, you're getting feedback from your peers in the program, feedback from your colleagues at work, right? So you're deploying and implementing some of the tools we're learning in this capstone project throughout the way. So our program has a really tight systems perspective that makes sense. There are common threads running throughout the program that, as we know, when they're tied tightly together, it actually creates a stronger bond than if they were just loose and fragmented. And this is one of the ways we do that, is through feedback and communication and being clear and honest and objective with people. So now I'll turn it back over to Dial to talk a little bit about details, but I encourage anyone to reach out to us with questions, reach out to me with questions. I'm happy to chat in more detail and go from there. So hopefully you learned a little bit about us and how we approach things, and look forward to seeing you down the road. Thank you.
Thanks, Matt. I really appreciate that. So what I would like to do is just go over our General Motors Executive MBA program, which gives you the opportunity. It has 36 credit hour programs with a total of 12 courses, which can be taken over 24 months. This breaks down to 2 courses per semester, with each course being 8 weeks in length. The program is delivered 100% online, and our next start is coming this spring semester, January 13th, 2020. Our current program cost is $37,080 with a 15% General Motors corporate and dealership discount available. The admissions process is as follows. After learning about our MBA program, it offers you the opportunity to ask, what is next? Our admissions process is fairly simple. Applicants must have graduated with a bachelor's from an accredited university, completed online application. You can use the application fee waiver code NUCEP. Request official transcripts from all previous colleges and university attended. Submit a current resume or CV. Interview with admissions representatives such as myself, Dial Delaney, as well as note that there's no GMAT or GRE required for our master's degree program. We want to thank you for attending our webinar today. We do want to offer you the opportunity to answer questions, to ask questions. So please type them into the chat box on the right side. You are receiving an email with our contact information in case you have any questions. As a reminder, our spring semester begins January 13th, and now is the right time to apply, especially with no application, with an application fee waiver. Thank you again for your time, and have a great day.